password.
Hello again. We are back after a brief unscheduled mid-season break. One would think that live streaming the process of making a video would make it easier to make a video, but no, it's the opposite. It only threw me off the track. Iron Sword is the sequel to one of my favorite NES games, Wizards and Warriors. While the original arcade classic did not have passwords, only a high score list, the sequel does, and in fact, it kicks you into the password screen almost as soon as you start the game. Now, as we established in the making of video, only 16 different letters are accepted. This list is almost the same as in Solar Jetman, which we covered in a previous episode. Each of these letters is actually a hexadecimal digit that just looks like a letter. For example, this password corresponds to the hexadecimal number 28378055022. These digits, called nibbles, are then divided into groups of 2 digits each, forming 6 bytes, bytes 0 through 5. Now the data in these bytes is encrypted, as it has been in almost every game we have covered so far. In Iron Sword, the encryption looks like this. Basically, a ton of xoring is happening around. Nothing too exciting or worth memorizing. Let's see how to decrypt this example password. First, bytes 0 and 3 are both xored with byte 5. This produces values EA and 9D respectively. Then all 5 bytes are xored using a hard-coded table that we will study later. This produces values D7, FC, 7A, DB and OB. Then level number is extracted from the XOR of bytes 4, 0 and 1. If the value is greater than 3E, the password is rejected. Here the value is 20, which is OK. Then bytes 2 and 3 are XORed with values from 2 other lookup tables using the level number as a key. Boy, they really did not want anyone to find out by accident how the password system works. Using hard-coded lookup tables is an efficient way to do that. Finally, a checksum is calculated from the XOR of the low nibbles of bytes 0, 1, 2 and 3 and the high nibbles of bytes 0 and 1. This checksum must be 0, which it is. The game uses the low nibble of byte 3 to store the intermediate result for the checksum, and it becomes 0 in the process. As a product, we get these bytes, D7, FC, FC and FO. We can ignore bytes 4 and 5, because byte 5 was only used for encryption and byte 4 only produced the level number, which we already have. The rest of the bytes contain various things in various bits. The weapon level, the shield level, the armor level, the number of remaining uses for a total of 7 spells, the number of extra lives, the number of keys, and an unknown 2-bit bitmask. The values for the items go like this, as indicated in the table on the screen. There is nothing too exciting about this table. There are some discrepancies between how the values are stored in the password and how they are represented in the game RAM, but it is pretty straightforward. There is one unknown variable, which I have not figured out what it does. It can have 4 different values, but judging from the disassembly, it looks like a 2-bit bitmask. So let's move on to the encryption now. We already touched this a bit when doing the decryption, but I think it warrants some special study. First, the game chooses an encryption key. For the purposes of producing valid passwords, technically any arbitrary byte would work, but the game generates it by XORing the 5 data bytes together. Actually, this is not the first step. It's done pretty late in the process, but I wanted to get it out from the way first. Anyway, it begins from calculating a 4-bit checksum. The checksum is placed in byte 3, which had its bottom part 0 if you recall. Byte 4 is calculated by XORing together the level number and the first 2 bytes, which contain stuff. Then bytes 2 and 3 are XORed using tables, and all bytes are XORed using another table. Then bytes 0 and 3 are XORed with the encryption key, which is stored in byte 5. So, about those tables. First, we have the 5-byte table. It contains the values 3DCBFA46 and 09. Here is the relevant part of the data from the disassembly of the ROM. The table begins at address FB8E. Can you find it? Here, let me make it a little bit bigger. There we go. The table stands out nicely there. It's a section of data in the middle of some code, just 5 bytes. Then we have table 1 and table 2. These are actually stored in an interleaved format in the ROM, such that both tables begin from the same address, 1 byte apart, and each successive element is 2 bytes away from the next. Such format is common in NES games because of performance reasons. It's basically a single table of byte pairs. So the table begins at address FB6A. Let's see if we can find it in the disassembly. Where is FB6A? FB6A is up here. But something is wrong. This is code, not data. Surely I misread something. No, the starting address definitely is FB6A. The data really is located here. They just chose a random part of the code and reused that code as data. Design-wise, this is the craziest thing that I have seen NES games do, and I was totally flabbergasted when I found this out. I streamed it live. You can actually find it on my channel. This data not only repurposes program code as data, but it even overlaps two other data arrays. That's right. The first XORing table we studied is actually part of the second and third table as well. In the bottom of the screen there is another data table that is used for some unknown purpose, and that table is also part of this encryption table. This kind of design would be totally fine if it was used for something insignificant like the random number generator in the game, but this is used as part of something that is exposed to the users. It is used to encrypt the passwords of the game. If they decided to release another revision of the game later, as many companies do, they could not change this code, because changing the code would invalidate all passwords that players have written down. And that makes this the wonkiest password design that I have seen so far, even beating Bomberman and Solar Jetman with their potential for arbitrary code execution exploits. So naturally, I also wrote an encoder-decoder or codec for this password system as well. This was done in PHP because it happens to be a scripting language that I am quite fluent with. Again, you can watch the live stream to find out how I approached reverse engineering this scheme. I am Bisqwit. In the next episode, we will study a game with a password scheme that is so unorthodox that it is difficult to even write them down. See you then!